understanding psychopathology, and I believe that you would have received weeks three reading material and the video clips, just to underscore that you are required. I think there are two videos that are going to be a part of the classroom lecture on Monday, and want to invite you to go individually to this website called Annenberg's Learner. I believe Mr. Nyama will give you directions as to how to go, but it is looking at abnormal behavior. That clip is, I think it's about 50 minutes long, and it's very, very important that you look at the video and come for discussion, because we're going to be starting the DSM, actually the introduction to the DSM. And at that time, I'm going to be looking at object relations and attachment theory, and you'll find out why I'm going to be lumping that with that topic for Monday. But for this evening, primarily, I want to wrap up on the matter of models of psychopathology. The last time that we spoke, we were on the matter of Freud, and I talked about primarily that there are three basic, what I see, three basic eras of the models. One was the, what I call the supernatural tradition, that basically psychopathology was basically seen in a very simplistic way. Nature and the nature of spirits ruled, and so people looked at the supernatural. So it was a very, very primitive period, but it also paved the way for psychopathology as we understand it. And I said one of the primary hallmarks or features of that tradition was triphoning, where people believe that the evil spirits dwell within the mind. And so you'll find that through that tool, it's a matter of letting the spirits, so it's called triphoning. I also talked about what I call the pre-modern era, and I gave a history of mental illness, talked a lot about Freud, the historical trends of Charcot and Breuer, and that tradition, which I think you can read, and I'm going to now recommend that you read, and I want you to let me know. You can unmute your next answer this question. The Barlow and Duran article, is that, have you ever seen that article on that was posted? Barlow and Duran. Has anybody seen? Was that article posted on the platform?
What was it?
Anybody? Barlow and Duran.
Is it a PDF document?
It's a PDF document. Was it abnormal? Barlow and Duran are the authors. Was it? Are you familiar with this article? With this PDF document?
I don't recall seeing the document.
Huh?
I haven't recalled seeing it.
Okay, all right. Well, I will be sending that to you among with some notes, as some people are asking about sending notes, reminding me about notes. That article will be sent. It will sort of encapsulate what we have been talking about in terms of the models, and I really recommend that you read it in preparation for Monday's lecture. But let me just wrap up with Freud to say that basically Freud's main premise, Freud laid the foundation for the modern era. He laid the foundation for the modern era, and his work primarily was an emphasis on psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis. So if you have time, you can take some notes, or you can listen to the lecture, but it's important. He paved the way for a very major theory in psychopathology called psychoanalysis. And psychoanalysis looks basically at the role of the unconscious, in determining behavior. the role of the unconscious in determining behavior. So what is this unconscious? It is that part of the psyche that where memories are. It plays a role in the mediation between the ego and the superego. Let me repeat. It is that part of the mind that tends to mediate between the role of the ego and the superego. The ego is more rational. The id is impulsive. And the superego mediates between the id and the ego. It is where the role of defense mechanisms come about. Defense mechanisms. And let me go into that quickly, because defense mechanisms. Now, the defense mechanisms are psychological processes. Defense mechanisms are psychological processes. Psychological processes that tend to regulate the emotions. And they regulate the emotions. So they guide the emotions. They have several functions. Defense mechanisms have several functions. One, it reduces anxiety. It reduces anxiety Two, it plays a role in protecting the person's psychological function. It helps deal with psychological function. Three, it helps to mediate conflict. It helps to mediate conflict and regulates the propensity for disturbance, psychological disturbance. Four, it plays a role in helping to release tension. That is emotional tension. And the release of tension known as emotional material. Emotional material is known as catharsis. 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 It plays a role in insight. In other words, the person's understanding of how unconscious events become conscious. So it helps in making the unconscious conscious, so to speak. Any questions so far? Mute your mics. Are there any questions?
One quick question, Dr. Mack. Yes. You had mentioned which one of these states you had said the defense mechanism is born out of. I missed that part. The id ego or super ego? I missed when you said the.
I must have chopped up myself. I'm sorry. What I'm saying is that defense mechanisms come primarily out of. they are primarily unconscious. And so they are part of the psyche. They are processes that are part of the psyche. They help to mediate between the ego and the superego.
Okay.
That's what I meant to say. My apologies. Any other questions before we continue? Any other questions on the introduction to defense mechanisms?
Dr. Matt, could you repeat the last statement, please?
I said a lot, Mr. Barr.
No, just the last one, Dr. Mark. That I think Michelle asked you to clarify.
Okay, repeat. You have to prompt me because I said a lot. I don't remember.
You said it came out, defense mechanisms came out of the unconscious and mediates between the ego and the super ego.
Yes, okay, Mr. Barr. Okay, clarify. What is it? What's the question, Mr. Barr?
No, that was it. I just wanted to write that particular.
Okay, all right. Yes. All right. So basically then, defense mechanisms are really, excuse me, they are primitive. They are primitive processes that enable a person to really deal with anxiety and aid in survival. They are primitive in nature. They originate in the unconscious, and they also aid in survival. Another characteristic is they can be normal and or abnormal. By a mean abnormal, we all have defenses. I mean, abnormal means that we are able to, it enables us to interact with the environment. It enables interaction. Abnormality means that we have to, that we, it is, it, it aids, it will enable, it, it, the unconscious will become disturbed when there is, when anxiety cannot be dispelled. And why, let me give an example. So, for example, if you look at the traumatic disorders in the DSM, one of the primary mechanisms of trauma is disassociation. Let me repeat. One of the primary mechanisms in the trauma category of psychopathology is disassociation. One of the primary mechanisms of depression, as per the DSM, is what is known as anger turn inward. So each disorder does have, or categories of disorders, I should say, does seem to have a defense mechanism. Any questions before I further elaborate? Are there any questions?
So are you hearing me?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so are you saying therefore that defense mechanism is necessary, so to speak?
Yes, it is necessary. It is necessary for survival of the species. Okay. If you look at animals surviving in a jungle, you look at animals, you know, at a watering hole, and you look at lions and people going, and look what happens when a lion goes to the watering hole. What do you think happens? What goes off? The animals know in their minds that this animal comes out of the jungle. See, I'm going to be lunch, or so. there is a tension building up, and so they run. So it's part of the survival of the species.
But, so it would be then, Dr. Mac, like the skunk.
Yes. What about the skunk?
Let off the noxious smell, offensive smell, the knife, right? Mm-hmm. Right. Or the hedgehog that brings up the spikes.
Yes. That's a part of survival. But the pathological aspect of defense mechanisms is defense mechanisms is important because in Freud's system, the role of the, in other words, there is a belief that all memories are based, all memories are based upon past experience. And so, in order for people to move along the life cycle, that there has to be a resolution of each stage of development. There must be. If there is no resolution of the stages of development, it is called a fixation. And with each fixation, there is going to be developed intrapsychic tension. So it is. So the defense mechanisms does seem to suggest that it is that our behaviors are unconscious. Our behaviors are unconscious. Our behaviors are unconscious. And the three personality, the Freud system of the ego is the one that has more, is more rational. So what it happens, so the ego tends to mediate between the id and the superego and be able to keep it tends to keep destructive conflicts in check. So when you look at the DSM-5, for example, and you look at all some of these disorders, for example, a child, for example, and we haven't talked about children yet, and we look a little bit on introduction to psychopathology, developmental psychopathology, which I'll try to talk about, is that if you look at a child, a young child who tends to wet the bed, or a child who has enuresis or encopresis, do you know what that is? Unmute your mics. Do you know what enuresis or encopresis is?
One is bedwetting, not sure which one.
Well, enuresis.
And feces is something.
And encopresis is the act of avoiding. But anyway, enuresis is a sign of emotional distress. It can mean, and we'll look at that when we look at the child with disorders, but enuresis is said that the child is, in terms of the defenses, a reaction formation. So when a child wets their bed, it means that they're dealing with internal trauma, and bed wetting is like a conversion hysteria or a conversion reaction, where emotional conflicts tend to masquerade as physical symptoms. Is that clear?
Dr. Mark?
Yes.
Is this a general consensus, or is it after a particular period of time that a child would wet the bed, you categorize that child as such?
Thank you. That's an excellent question. I think, well, the generally one would diagnose enuresis because there are two types, diurnal, meaning the day, and nocturnal. Generally the DSM, it really is in a sense a medical disorder, even though it's under this, in the DSM-5 as a mental disorder, because a child who is enuretic or has enuresis does have a comorbid disorder called depression. So more than like a child, so the depression is masquerading itself as in form of bedwetting. Because remember, children cannot, they're not able to express themselves. So in terms, what you're seeing is child who wets, in one aspect, primarily if there is no physical cause for the bedwetting, and you can now allude to emotional causes. It is said that a child who has enuresis can also be depressed. That's why they get antidepressants. Imipramine is one such drug that treats enuresis. It functions as a, as a, as a, it's a, it's a I think the general is Elleville in children, so it's good to treating. It can be treated. Antidepressants can treat the enuresis, or the bell and pad is another technique used to treat it. Did that answer your question?
Somewhat, Dr. Mark. But what I'm still unclear of is there a specific period of time that we could say over three months period when a child is getting their bed?
Well, there are certain diagnostic criteria for enuresis.
Okay.
That you need to be aware of. I mean, the DSM, it must give credence to the fact that this it must start before a certain time. So you look at age of onset in the DSM, in the DSM-5, or in psychopathology, we look at emerging disorders or resolving disorders. We have either a disorder that emerges or resolves. So we are going to look at age of onset, time of onset, duration of symptoms. Age of onset, time of onset, duration of symptoms. So those are the avenues you will look at in terms of determining if this is enuresis or it's something else. Is it clear? So a child's age or a person or adult's age, for example, let's say again, for example, you can have for antisocial personality disorder, you can't diagnose a child with personality disorders except if there is some evidence of childhood disturbances like conduct. You only diagnose a personality disorder at age 18. That is the age of onset. Schizophrenia starts in early 20s for males primarily. So if you have someone with late onset schizophrenia, it may mean something else, but each disorder has a certain time of onset. Major depressive episode, it must be, the acuity of the symptoms must be 4 weeks, or it must be 6 months or less. So even with, for example, PTSD, jumping the gun a little bit, but PTSD versus PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, versus an acute stress disorder. One is, in the case of PTSD, it must be 6 months in duration. So if it goes beyond the 6 months, it is PTSD. An acute stress disorder, same symptoms, but it's a time of onset that makes a difference. It's less than 6 months. Is it clear?
Crystal, Dr. Mark, crystal.
Oh, thank you for my brilliance, Mr. Barr. Okay, all right. Can we continue, ladies and gentlemen? Any other questions?
Not at this time for me.
Any other questions before we move on? Any other questions?
Not at this time.
Not from me, Dr. Okay.
Yes, Ms. Osborne, you have a question?
No, I'm saying not at this time.
Oh, I didn't hear you. I'm sorry. Anybody else?
Not at this time, Dr. Okay,
so it's clear?
Yes, Dr. Could
someone remind me where I last stopped, please? I went off the deep end. I apologize.
Keeping the conflict in check. Keeping the conflict in check.
Keeping the conflict in check about what?
Id and super ego.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. The defense mechanisms?
Yes, Dr. Behaviors are unconscious, and ego tends to mediate between id and superego,
yes,
and
yes,
keeps destructive conflict in check.
In other words, the ego, in Freudian psychoanalysis, it is the ego that maintains the balance between unconscious conflict and the manifestation of anxiety. It too much anxiety, failure of defense mechanisms. When you have too much anxiety, your defenses are failing. Too much anxiety, your defenses are failing.
So, Dr. Mack, I missed something. Ego maintains the balance between between conscious conflict and what, Dr. Mack?
Let's see if I can recall what I said. Ego, repeat.
Ego maintains the balance between conscious conflict and, I missed the and part. It's all right, we hear it on the tape and the playback. It's okay, Dr. Mack, go.
I'm not getting my facts, but I wanted to underscore this.
That's all right.
That, that there are two types of defenses, major types in terms of nature of it. One is what I call primitive defenses. I explain. Primitive defenses and two high-order defenses. Primitive defenses and high-order defenses. The primitive defenses are those defenses that are deep in the subconscious. They come across in as a part of repressed memories. Repressed memories. So an example of a primitive defenses is that they're unstable. Defenses are unstable. They are rooted in conflict. So let's see if I, disassociation is one primitive defenses. It represents a disconnection between mind and body. Where anxiety, it represents a disconnection between mind and body, where anxiety is represented in physical symptoms. Anxiety is represented in physical symptoms. Let me give an example of that, of a disassociation. I'll give you an example, and I'll give you a case that I am treating with a lady right now. But let's say, for example, disassociation is when a person is, let's say, for example, an abuse, a person goes through sexual abuse, may develop multiple ego states or personality states, called dissociative identity disorder. I think someone is going to, one group is going to be dealing with that on Monday. Am I correct? I see someone shaking their head. So, so disassociation is more primarily a disconnection between mind and body. It's avoiding painful memories. It's avoiding it, so the mind, so the person, it can manifest itself in repressed memories. It can manifest itself in a fugue state, like wondering about losing your memory, like dissociative fugue, a fugue state. Or it can manifest itself in paralysis, where the person may become blind, for example, or the person cannot speak. That's disassociation. That is a very primitive. It's where trauma is much more there, and it is intense and it's conflicted. And so it's so painful that it has to remain in the unconscious, called repressed memories. Unmute your mics. Is that clear so far?
Barry is good, Dr. Mack.
Yes, Dr.
Mack. I didn't hear you. Hello?
Sir, Dr. Mack.
Very okay. All right. One last one I want to talk about, just because it's important, is of the primitive defenses, is splitting. Splitting. Now, splitting, and we haven't dealt with object relations yet. We'll do that on Monday. But splitting is compartmentalizing ego and emotional states. It's compartmentalizing ego and emotional states. It compartmentalizes objects in terms of good or bad. So we look at, so splitting is more dualistic in nature of negative and positive emotions. So people who are, so borderline, another person who's doing the borderline, you will find that they tend to devalue people. They either devalue devaluing persons, or they tend to engage a person. So it's called splitting in the borderline personality disorders. Splitting is based upon the inability. Splitting is based upon the inability for the mental image. I'll explain the mental image to see objects in whole. To see objects in whole. Objects, continue, I'm still continue to write. Objects are normally seen as normally called mental representation. Objects are normally seen as mental representation. However, if there is a disturbance in the world of the object, if there is a disturbance in the world of object, the object will be fragmented. The object will be fragmented and cannot be stable in the external environment. Environment. Unmute your mics and ask questions. I know that's probably questions for people to ask at this time. Are there any questions? I know there should be. I mean, I won't touch on because this is very technical and I will do that on Monday. But any questions so far? Miss Mighty, Ella Jean, you said yes, Dr. Mark. Any questions? Is she hearing me? Mr. Nami?
Yes, she's hearing. Ella Jean is hearing. She just can't.
No, it is clear. Is it what you're saying? You can type.
Say yes.
Okay, good. Dr. All right. Mark. Yes. I'm not so clear as to the last thing you said. You're saying that the person, if there's a disturbance, the person will see the image. Okay. The word of mental representation is object relations. This is very important in psychopathology, because object relations is a systematic theory of personality, and it seems to talk about it talks about early formation of personality, but it is known as a mental representation. So all of us have some image of people in our minds in the past, correct?
Right.
Unmute your mics. Yes.
Right. Yes.
Now yes. Yes. Document.
So the images that we have are good and bad, correct?
Indeed.
Yes, document. And if the images are good and bad, what it means, a good object means that we are able to relate to others based upon those positive images in the past. That's called mental. So in our memories, it's called a mental representation.
Okay.
So. Have you ever heard sometimes when people say you have a bad transference? Like you see, she reminds me of my mother. He reminds me of my father. That is what is called projective identification. That's another defense, where people tend to portray their unwanted feelings on other people.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. I will explain more. I don't want to confuse this, because what I want you to do, ladies and gentlemen, is please read the handout on object relations. I put a PowerPoint on it. We'll talk about it on Monday. We'll have Mr. Nami put the PowerPoint on to discuss on the chat for us to go through the PowerPoint. It's important. Please read the PowerPoints and the handout I gave you before we can for class. But let's continue. The second major defense is the higher order defenses.
How do you spell that, Dr. Ma?
Beg your pardon?
Can you spell it for me, please?
Okay. High order. H-I-G-H.
High order. Okay.
Yes. High order defenses. But what I mean by high order defenses are defenses that are mediated primarily by the ego. That is consciousness. You are aware of what you're doing. So high order defenses are less disturbed. You have less disturbance. So you more rationalize. The defenses are more in the thoughts, in the cognitions. And you tend to, so one engages in intellectualization to avoid painful anxiety. You tend to, it's more in the cognitions, the thoughts. So, it's not only in the thoughts, but the higher order defenses means that the person is able to, when anxiety is emerging, the person is able to deal with the anxiety, but that the anxiety manifests itself. The anxiety manifests itself behaviorally. The anxiety tends to manifest itself behaviorally, from cognitions to behavior. Let me give an example. A defense mechanism called reaction formation. Reaction formation is one such high-order defenses. This is the attempt to deal with conflict, intra-psychic conflict. The attempt to deal with intra-psychic conflict, by using psychological resources that are opposed to one's own acceptable thoughts or feelings. To one acceptable thoughts or feelings. I'll give an example of a defense. A man who dislikes his mother-in-law intensely buys her expensive gifts. That's reaction for me. Do you see? Unmute your mics. Do you understand?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Mr. Chiana has joined us.
Good evening, Dr. Mark.
One more high order defense. Is passive aggression. Have you ever heard of that term? Unmute your mic. Have you ever heard of that defenses? Hello?
Yes.
Tell us, what do you think it means?
I think it's something like you probably are you hearing?
I am. Go ahead.
Okay. Like probably you might be upset about something, but you're not necessarily showing that you're upset directly.
Yes.
In terms of your action.
Yes. What kind of action?
You know, it would come out. Yeah. Sorry?
Go ahead.
Yeah, in terms of your action, you know, it will show in what you're doing that you are angry. You may not necessarily know that you are angry, you're upset.
Give an example. Explain some more, please. Give an example. Give us an example of what you mean.
Okay. I'm not sure I have an example.
May I try?
Go ahead, please.
Yes,
go ahead.
For example, a husband is upset with his wife for whatever reason, and he may not say to her that he's upset, but in the way in which he probably shares the food for her may show that he's upset, or probably he may not necessarily want to do something that she may have asked him to do for her.
Mm-hmm.
So he may use the fact that he's upset, he may not necessarily do things the way he used to, but it will show that he's upset by his mannerism and his behavior.
Right.
Give an example.
For example, Dr. Matt, the wife may say something to him, may call him a particular name, and he doesn't necessarily say to her, I don't like that, or speak to her. He just...
Yeah.
Goes about like all is okay, in that he will go and share the food at the same time, and maybe even come and rub her foot.
Could that not be
aggressive?
Okay, no, but could not that be? Why could not that be denial? Tell me.
Oh.
That sounds like denial to me.
Denial to you?
Yes. Of reality.
All right. He's upset and he doesn't say anything to her, but he treats her in a disrespectful way.
Or probably when he's sharing the food, he probably slams the pot or something to find another way to allow his anger to come out. But
that
he will
seems
not necessarily...
more like it to me. Yes. Oh. Yes. In other words, it is passive aggression is displaying passive behaviors. Passive emotional conflict in active behaviors send a signal or send a message. That's what it is. All right, I tell you what we do. Mr. Naomi, could you assist us? Could you I want you to just to see if you can get some practice on the defenses. We will be able to learn them when you use them in when you when we look at some little veneers and we will say what. I want you to look at what you have, your defense mechanisms, the handout I gave you, and I want you to read for the. I'm gonna also bring up my bring up mine, and let's see if we can go through them. Now, if I move the, can you still see me if I go to my notes?
Yes, we'll see you, but
yes,
but we won't see your notes though.
No, you don't need to see my notes. I want you to see me.
Yeah, we'll still see you.
All right. So let me. I'm trying to look at the common. It's called common. There is the notes that I sent by email. Can I click on it and find it? Can it come up? If I click on it, will I be able to read it?
Yes, once it will open on your screen.
Yes, let's do that. Let's do that that way then. Let's do a couple, and I'm going to ask each of you to comment and give me the justification as to why it is. So let's look at the first one. It's loading. Are you able to see it on screen?
No, they won't be able to see it.
Or they won't be able to see it.
You'll have to tell us which one you're looking at.
Okay, I think I don't know the wrong one. I'll go back to. I'm looking at the one on the
worksheet.
The veneers on. Yes, let's go to the worksheet, please.
Okay.
Victor, did you see the link to the document?
Yeah, the power went. We have power cut.
Power cut?
Yes, Doctor.
Okay, you can't see. Can you see it?
Yeah, I can see it now.
Okay. You know JP is still cutting off lights down in your all right. Let's look at the worksheet. Notes number one. There are some.
I lost mine. I'm trying to find it back, and I'm clicking where you told us to go the first time, but it's not coming back up.
Okay, he sent another link, I believe. So let me see found it. If you, you can click on the link, please, that you can bring it up on your computer, then we can talk up, then you can see what we're talking about.
Okay. Which one, Dr. Matt? Which one is
the We're gonna go through them for a couple and then I want to continue with the models of psychopathology and wrapping up. But this is important.
Hey,
okay.
What's up, Renee?
Hello, Mr. Bar. Oh yeah, I took a coming on.
All right.
Sorry, guys.
Okay. Do we have the worksheet up? Are people seeing the worksheets?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
No. Somebody says no. Who is not seeing it? Hello?
I'm taking more.
I'm trying again.
Did Vanessa join us?
Okay.
Dr. Matt, just confirming, is the worksheet titled Defense Mechanisms Worksheet?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, I'm seeing it now.
Has Vanessa joined us? Let's see. I haven't seen it. Okay. I thought I heard her voice. All right. Let's go to let's go to number one, and I'll read. Sally is 18 years old and unexpectedly pregnant. she had big plans to go to college, but now tells everyone how much she's looking forward to being a mother. Which one from your notes? Can tell me what is this? Which defense mechanism is it? Tell me if it's primitive or is it high order?
High order.
And justify which defense method. We're going to do a couple. Any answers so far?
High order reaction formation.
Sorry?
I would say high order reaction formation. Because she's a model student and she has now apparently gotten pregnant and she's now saying that she's looking forward to the baby because she doesn't want the people to feel as if she is a failure. So she's reacting to the fact that she's now pregnant and thinking that she has.
Anybody else?
Yes.
I'll hold my. Withhold my response until other people have answered. Anybody else?
I think it's the primitive one.
Who am I speaking with?
Eileen.
Okay. Yes, Miss Osborne. Go ahead.
And I think it's dissociation.
Okay.
You know, with the stress of in a way that is not real, you know, it's kind of breakdown in terms of reality. So in terms of, she has her ambition, but you know, that's her reality. Wants to go to college.
Yes.
But then something happens, and then she's kind of shifting her reality, so to speak.
But remember, that I talked to you about this association before. That this association. So are you arguing that it's a primitive defense? Remember I said that where there is more primitive, when the defenses are primitive, the deep disturbance. Is there any evidence that there is a deep disturbance in the vineyard? Think about it.
Not really.
Is there any evidence of that?
I don't think so.
Cool. So give another guess.
Thinking about it.
Okay. Somebody else? Anybody else?
I agree with Bar that it's high order. And I think she's in denial. Probably because of her expectation, and probably she believed that people will say things about her.
Okay. So we have one reaction formation and one denial. Justify that, because in cases you're gonna have to justify why you say that. Why do you say that? Where's your evidence? Where's your evidence?
I think but probably not denial, because I'm sorry, probably she's not refusing to accept reality. I think she may accept it, but she may.
Cause she what?
No, I don't think it's denial. I'm changing my position.
Yes.
Could it be reaction formation?
I think it's reaction formation. I don't think it's denial.
Okay. Well, we have two students with reaction formation changing. Anybody else before I chime in? Anybody else?
Dr. Mack, one quick question. It says here the choices are all of those at the top, repression and so forth and so on. Are we supposed to use any of those, or just looking at the primitive and the higher order as it relates to reaction, passive?
I believe that those examples have those defenses, so you choose which one.
Well, I would say compensation.
Why compensation? What's the evidence?
Because she wanted to go to college, and she, it doesn't say it here, but she might have been a little bit upset about it, the fact that she became pregnant unexpectedly.
Okay.
And so though she's looking forward to it, she has compensated by saying, you know what, I'm looking forward to being a mother. That is
okay. All right. Sounds reasonable.
Yes, it does.
Anybody else?
No, but I think the reaction formation, you know, she is saying that, but that is not exactly what she believes. I think she believes the opposite of that. So that is why I choose reaction formation.
Someone is staggering me with their
brilliant.
Miss Osborne?
Yes, ma- yes, Dr. Matt.
You're staggering me with your eruditeness. You know what eruditeness means? It means learned brilliance. Or an epiphany. Who is laughing? Staggering us with your brilliance. Tell us more. Give us, stagger us. You have what I call an enlightened epiphany. Go ahead, Mr. Osman.
No, I'm just thinking that from what I read, that the reaction formation, when you're faced with something,
yes,
you begin to accept what you're really, opposite of what you really believe. And that is really a defense mechanism to deal with the situation. So you said, okay, I'm not going to get to college, I have to go to college, which is what I really want.
Yes.
So to appease myself and others, let me say, okay, I'm looking forward to being a mother, instead of saying I'm disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
In the fact that I won't be able to go to college at this point. So I'm disappointed. So let me just brush it off and say, okay, then I am looking forward to being a mother. So to me, that's what reaction formation is.
Okay. All right. So far we have had 3 answers and 1 compensation. Anybody else before I chime in? Because we have to, a couple more, then we have to move on to the other lecture. Anything else? Anybody else? Anybody else? All right. I think it's the persons who talked about compensation versus reaction formation, and some person had said and then changed is denial. Reaction formation is correct. Why is it correct? Because if you look at the this is what I want you to do. You look at the reaction formation suggests that there is the person is it shows that disappointment. It shows in a reaction formation is a substitute. There is always a substitution for an emotion. So in other words, if there is a positive emotion, it's done opposite and vice versa. So it's a substitution for a feeling. And so the person does it in the opposite way. Why would it not be compensation, Miss Williams? What's compensation? What does compensation mean? Why would it not be compensation?
What does compensation mean? Let me
think. Well, tell me what you think. What's your reason behind that?
Why I said it was compensation?
Yes.
Because she was saying that if it is that she cannot go to college, and I believe that she would have been disappointed,
yes,
in deciding to be a mother and embracing all of that. Being a mother wouldn't be such a bad thing. So she has decided to okay, compensate by being a mother versus being a college student. So if one, she might prefer one over the other. But mm-hmm. in reality, it shouldn't be such a bad thing. And so by embracing the whole idea of motherhood, she's hoping that it would let her not feel too badly about not having gone to college or not being able to go to college now, because she's still young.
I see where you're going with that, but here's the deal. That when one goes through a when one is compensating in it as a defense, it means that the person is making up for something that they feel that they have lacked. Okay, so let's say, for example, someone who has poor self-esteem. Someone who has poor self-esteem tends to show an exaggeration of behaviors in some way. So let's say someone has poor self-esteem. They try to make up for that lack of in terms of their behavior by doing something else to make themselves feel better. That's the difference.
Okay, I see what you're
saying. So reaction formation is a substitute for another emotion. Compensation means that you what you're doing is that you are adding to something that you don't have.
Okay.
You see the difference?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Okay, let's do two more, and then we're gonna go up, get out of this. Let's go to two. Someone can read it for me, please. Can someone read the second one for me, please?
Juan recently broke up with his fiancée. Now he's telling all of his friends that he was bored with the relationship.
All right. Tell me what that is now. What defenses is that?
I would say it's one of the high order defense system.
Okay,
and high order in the sense that it is it's certainly not disturbing. Certainly not disturbing, and it could be a part of the reaction formation where he is, as you say, substituting one emotion for the next.
Okay, so which defense is it? What do you say? What's your choice?
Reaction formation.
Okay.
High
good.
Order.
Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else?
I would support that claim, Dr. Matt, that it is reaction formation.
And why?
Simply because of the stated reason that he is saying that, hey, you know, these are the reasons why I don't want the relationship. My question to Dr. Matt, can reaction formation have a touch of rationalization?
Good point. What are you driving at?
Because he is rationalizing to say to his friends, these are the reasons why I no longer want a relationship because I am bored.
Rationalization is far more sophisticated than that.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we see let me explain. Reaction formation is really part of what is called known as a cognitive dissonance. Okay? It's part of a cognitive dissonance. In other words, in order for you to resolve an emotion that is painful, you're correct, you rationalize it, but it's more doing something the opposite. So what you do is that, in a sense, it's part of rationalization, you're correct, Mr. Barr, but it's more focused on the person's reducing the dissonance in your thoughts about the fact that there was a breakup, but saying, okay, it's more looking at two states and choosing the one that makes them feel better. That's reaction formation. Now, when one rationalizes, rationalization is more trying to make some sense out of one's behavior that one feels uncomfortable with. So, for example, a man who steals, or a person who cheats, Yes.
Sorry, I don't mean to cut you. But yes. would Robin Wood be a perfect example of rationalization?
Absolutely. Explain.
That he says that the system is oppressive, so he robs from the rich.
Eruditeness. Eruditeness.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Epiphany.
He has what I call a perceived epiphany. An ascent into what I call an orb of brilliance. Very good, Mr. Barr.
Appreciate that.
Yes, that is rationalization. Someone says, I think he's in denial. Miss Mighty? Hello? She's saying, type and let us know, why would it be denial? What's your reasoning? Tell us what your reason is for saying he's in denial. Waiting for her chat. While we do that, let's go on to let's go on to the third, and then we're gonna stop on that for now. Could someone read the third the vignette, please?
Frankie is always trying to keep up with his older brother when playing sports, but he can't. He takes great delight in bringing home a good report card instead.
Who can tell? So in other words, let us know what is that. Tell us what is the defense, and note the action. There's always defenses are linked with cognitions and action. What's the cognition? What's the action? There's an event that one's reacting to. What is it? Which defense is this?
Would it be compensation?
Okay. Anybody else?
I agree, Dr. Matt, that it is compensation.
Yes.
Simply because I guess Frankie is not as athletic as his older brother, so he said, listen, you can do sports, I will take my book for it. And I gather that's why many of us have come to CGST, Dr. Matt, because they're not good at sports.
So there is in the action, there is element of a need to make up for a deficiency, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Something that he lacked.
Yes, so you're all correct. Very good. Just to answer Miss Helogene's what she said, I think he's in denial. He might regret the fact that the relationship has ended, and in order to deal with the painful aspect, he plays it off by saying the relationship was boring. True, but could we engage her? Why would it not be denial? For the second one, why would it not be denial? Do you agree with what she said? She's talking about the second vignette.
Doctor Matt?
I think he accepted the fact that the relationship is over, but he's just trying to, he's trying to at least protect himself then. Like,
yes,
him as it wasn't his fault.
Okay. So.
So I believe he accepted the fact that the relationship is over, but yes, he's just trying to make it seem as if it wasn't his fault.
Okay.
Because he was born or something. Or he's the one who actually ended the relationship.
All right. What's okay? Let me explain about denial because I think it's better that, and then she'll be able to understand. And you may want to take some notes. Denial, ladies and gentlemen, is avoiding the fact of reality. It is distorting reality in order to deal with anxiety that is overwhelming. Are you agreeing with me? I heard a noise. In other words, so denial is the cognitions taking place. It is attempting to restructure the thoughts to reflect reality or to reflect an avoidance of reality. Denial is a conscious effort to distort reality. It's a conscious effort to avoid painful interaction with the truth. That's what it is.
So Dr. Mark.
Yes.
Am I to understand that when an individual has lost someone or going through the grieving process, and the first stage is denial, am I to understand that it is a conscious reaction to the situation? Because I always thought that it just came almost natural for the person. No, sir. The person has not.
Well. It is. In one sense, the person has to consciously manipulate schemas in their thoughts,
mm-hmm.
or manipulate scripts in their thoughts. In other words, it's denial is part of what is of the metacognition of thinking. So it's a process that one has to engage in to alter what's reality.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
So what you say?
Yes. All right, let us move off. I think basically people have had a sense of what this of defenses. You know what defenses are. You know how they operate in psychopathology. Am I correct? Unmute your mics. Am I correct?
You are correct, Dr. Matt.
Can we move on to the rest of the other models? Hello? Are we ready now?
Yes, I'm ready, Doctor.
Okay. All right. So we're gonna end with Freud in that pre-modern era, and we're gonna be now advancing to the modern era of models. So Freud's psychoanalysis paved the way for the modern era. Now, when we look at the modern era, we are looking at a reaction to psychoanalytic theory, that we are looking at a revolt to Freud's view of human nature to explain abnormality or to explain behaviors. So the modern period is going to look at the cognitive theories of to explain behaviors, looking at abnormality as learned behavior. Looking at developmental psychopathology in children as another cause of models of psychopathology. And we are also looking at what is known as the diathesis stress model. The diathesis stress model, D-I-A, diathesis, D-I-A-T-H-E-S-I-S, stress model. And we're going to be looking at Henry Murray's personology. Henry Murray's personology. Henry Morris, personology. So we are in the modern period. Just know that the modern period saw the rise of a revolt against the what I call the deterministic view of human behavior. That is not just based upon us unconscious. So the modern period, the modern era, marked the evolution of social, psychological, cognitive, and what I call the neurobiological aspects of to explain abnormality. Now let's take, for example, the role of abnormality as learned behavior. Abnormality as learned behavior. So there are two types in this learned behavior. We are looking at behaviors that are based upon paired associations. That is classical conditioning. So we look at the role of Pavlov in classical conditioning or paired associative behaviors, and two, social learning theory, the role of Skinner and Albert Bandura.
I'm hearing singing.
Okay, can someone mute their mics, please? I mean, I'm hearing it myself. Could some people mute their mics, please? Thank you. Okay. Yes. So we look at the Pavlonian behavior, which is important because Pavlov looked at of what is known as classical conditioning, that behaviors are learned by it's more stimulus, it's more based upon pairing of an unconditional response.
An unconditional stimuli.
To unconditional response, which will give a conditioned response. So it is suggesting that behaviors that I'm still hearing noise. I'm hearing it's in my head. Could people mute their mics, please? Thank you. That in terms of classical conditioning. Classical conditioning is linked to, especially in terms of the categories of anxiety disorders in the DSM. That there is the concern that there is, it's based upon a pairing of a negative of a negative event with a unconditional stimulus to make it conditional. So for example, the development of phobias, social phobias, panic attacks with agoraphobia is based upon classical conditioning. So let's say, for example, that if someone is bitten by a snake, there will be people will be if one sees a snake, you start to panic. That is classical conditioning, and it is saying that behaviors that it explains abnormal behavior, especially anxiety disorders, the panic attacks. Those are based upon classical conditioning. The second type of behavior is based upon operant conditioning. B.F. Skinner, for example. B.F. Skinner looks at the role of operants or reinforcers in the environment. So whereas Pavlov did more pairing of a stimulus, unconditioned, to get a conditioned response, which is unconscious, Skinner talks about reinforcers or operants that explains behavior. So, for example, someone who has a generalized anxiety disorder will be responding a stressor will be responding to the environment. So in operant conditioning, you're looking at the individual's response to environmental stress. So behaviors as in terms of classical conditioning versus operant is really based upon the person's the role of conditioning and the role of the person's behavior within the environment that is said to cause abnormality. And so in learned behavior, we're looking at the role of the cognitions and the person's ability to learn behavior. So behaviors are learned. So learning is based upon in the social context with the person that to explain abnormality, that the behaviors are learned, and as a result of learning, the person can develop, if the behaviors really are maladaptive, the person can develop abnormality. Unmute your mics and ask questions. Any questions? Clear as mud or crystal?
Crystal, Dr. Mark.
Okay, let's continue. Let's look then at the developmental psychopathology. Developmental psychopathology. That it is really based. It is really based. Developmental psychopathology. It is based upon a lifespan approach. It's a lifespan approach. In other words, the ability to negotiate and attain successfully, the ability to negotiate and to attain successfully early developmental tasks. Which would lead to fulfillment of other tasks to complete the life cycle. In other words, it is saying then that that psychopathology is based upon the success or the failure to thrive within the developmental cycles. It has several models within itself. It is how it gives us an understanding, and I'm continuing to write, ladies and gentlemen, it gives us an understanding of how children navigate the developmental cycle. A failure to navigate the cycle will lead to psychopathology as an adult. Let me repeat. A failure to navigate the cycle or the task successfully will lead to adult psychopathology. There are several models within this psychopathology framework. One, let me give them to you briefly. One, the interaction model. The interaction model. I'm going to go through this very briefly because I'm going to send also the notes to you. The interaction model looks at the role of vulnerability. And stress factors in children, known as risk factors, and I will not go through that tonight. We'll go through that in the when we look at developmental psychopathology in the DSM. It's known as risk factors. So this interactional model looks at predisposing factors. Predisposing factors where the role of genes take place are common. Predisposing. Also, under that same interaction, the role of precipitating factors. What is it in the environment that's causing this child to act out? Predisposing, precipitating. The third, perpetuating. Perpetuating. What is the homeostasis within the family dynamics that is maintaining this child's behavior? Predisposing, precipitating, perpetuating. Predisposing means that there is the role of the genes and nurture nature. Precipitating, acute stressors in the now. Perpetuating, a continuation of the problem in the child's ecological system. We look at Friend Bonner's ecological model. Not tonight, we look at it another time. Another model under the developmental psychopathology is the transactional model. That's two. The transactional model. Transactional model. It looks at normal and abnormal development in children. The child is an active agent in the environment. The child under this transactional model is an active agent in the environment. Active agent in the environment. And the child will—it's a child who will determine, or the child—I should say—it's a child's environment that will determine normal or abnormal functioning. That's the transactional model. The third model of child psychopathology is the biopsychosocial model. The biopsychosocial model. And this is the integration of understanding the role of genes and the environment. Combination, all the integration of the genes, the environment, and brain processes. The genes, environment, and brain processes. And lastly, under the models, the ecological model. The ecological model. This is Bonfen-Brenner's ecological model. Bonfen-Brenner, ecological model. And this briefly is the interaction between the child and family. Interaction between the child and family within a network of environmental influences, and how environment impacts the child in the family. Just a brief description of developmental psychopathology. Very brief. And I want to continue much more. I won't go in depth because I want to continue when I touch child and adult psychopathology. We discuss more. But just know that for now, that abnormal behavior is gradual in children. Abnormal behavior is gradual. Abnormal behavior revolves around the child and the environment. Abnormal behaviors is that there is also an integration and an interaction and an involvement. So integration, interaction, and an involvement. Of motivational processes, integration, interaction, and involvement of motivational processes to explain and understand what is known as the pathways of adaptation. The pathways of adaptation. Yes? Understand the pathways of adaptation and maladaptive behavior. I'm going to stop there under developmental for now until we get to the DSM. Any questions so far? Any questions? Are there any questions? Go ahead. Sorry?
No questions for me, Dr.
Any other questions, ladies and gentlemen? Ladies and gentlemen, any questions, please?
No question for me, Dr. Mark.
Okay, all right. Let's continue with what is known as the diathesis stress model. The diathesis stress model. I will continue with child psychopathology in another forum. I don't want to say too much tonight, but this is a major model of psychopathology. It's what is known as a neurobiological model. A neurobiological model, why? Because it involves the integration of the brain processes and genetics. The brain processes and genetics. The model states that people are prone, or some people I should say, are prone to what is known as a vulnerability factor. Known as a diathesis. The vulnerability factor is known as a diathesis. Diathesis. And when interacting with an environmental stressor or proximal stressor, proximal, it is known to cause a disorder. Both must be present for the disorder to occur. Note again, let me repeat. Both the diathesis and the environmental stressors must be present for the disorder or for the psychological disorder to occur. That's important. So, if you look at some of the DSM-5 diagnoses, it will explain, for example, people who have bipolar disorder. Some people may have it, some people have the genetic load for it. So, it's likely that somebody with a history of depression, so when you're asking for people who have depression, you need to ask history. You have to ask in your interview, is there any family history? Because you want to know, is there a genetic link? If there is a genetic marker, then it means that this is genetic in itself. And bipolar disorders do have genetics. So it will be highly likely if a parent of a child has it, the likelihood of the child getting bipolar disorder is pretty high. Let me say more about the diathesis stress model in a bit. That it is based primarily on, as I said, not just vulnerability, but there is certain risk. So the risk when there is a familial, or when there is a strong family component of our history of a disorder, there is a strong likelihood for this model to develop. schizophrenia is one such disorder that tends to revolve around this model. In this model of in terms of twin studies and family studies, it is said that the more genetically similar you are, like twins, the more genetically similar you are, the more prone you are for stressors in the environment. So, for example, schizophrenia, it is said that there is a strong genetic component as well as there are family disturbances. So, a person with schizophrenia, the family, it has been said, researchers said, that there is a high level of emotionality in the family. And the family's response to the person's illness is more likely to result in a relapse of the disorder. Secondly, continuing, is that the model is also rooted in early experiences. Or early experiences between the parent-child relationship. That is, the role of attachment plays a role, and we haven't touched that yet. Again, we'll look at that on Monday. More than likely, just want to underscore that we may not finish on Monday, we may have to go back to Saturday like this again to complete, because these are heavy. Monday, we may not finish Monday. We may have to go to next week, Saturday again to do that. But let's look at the fact of the relationship with the child and the parent based upon attachment, the role of attachment and the role of temperament in the child. Attachment and temperament. And coping skills in the child is important. It will be linked to a major stressor in the environment. So for children, let's say, for example, a child develops separation anxiety. What would be, unmute your mics, what would be for a child who develops separation anxiety? What would be the major diastasis?
That would be the attachment.
Beg your pardon?
It would be the attachment the child had with the parent. Probably the child had insecure attachment.
Come again?
Probably the child had attachment and insecure.
Yes.
Based on that, every experience that will affect the relationship between the child and the parent.
Okay. What will be the stressor in the child for separation anxiety? So, in other words, you're saying that one of the criteria is in attachment.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
okay. Separation anxiety. Now, unmute your mics. What is separation anxiety, ladies and gentlemen? What is it? From a layman's perspective, you haven't looked at the DSM yet. What is it?
The feeling that someone would get when they are being separated from maybe a primary caregiver or somebody that they have grown attached to over a period of time.
Okay. Anybody else?
I guess the child may be thinking that he's going to be losing me.
The what?
Maybe losing the person, mm-hmm. caregiver.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if every person is out of sight, you might think that he or she is losing the parent or the parent.
Okay. Anybody else?
A kind of anxiety that a child separation from
separation from what? Somebody was saying something and then they stopped. I didn't hear. What else?
Oh, I was saying something, Dr. Matt, but I thought somebody else was talking. It's Marshally. I was saying separation anxiety, how I see this kind of anxiousness that a child undergoes when the caregiver is out of sight or absent.
Okay.
Dr. Matt, could it be, okay, go ahead.
Yes.
Is it a perceived separation that brings down that anxiety?
Perceived separation
that brings down the anxiety.
In what way, Mr. Barr? Explain.
For example, you bring a child to the daycare.
Yes.
Either the mother or the father, normally it's the mom. And
yes.
The child knows that the mother is going to leave at some point in time and begins to cry profusely because she doesn't want the mother or the parent or the caregiver to leave.
Okay.
That's why I say a perceived separation.
Okay, but okay. So we agree then that a child attachment is important in a child's ability to navigate the world and the environment, correct?
Yes, Dr. Matt.
So a child who has separation anxiety, now in my mind there are two types of separation anxiety. I don't want to belabor the point anymore, but there are two types. One is in terms of explaining this model, this diathesis stress model, in that children who are have secure attachment will undergo separation anxiety, but it is transient. In other words, the child learns that there is object permanence with objects. That if I don't see mommy or daddy in 2 hours, when I go home I'll see them. So this type of response separation is in response to the child's disruption temporarily of the homeostasis of the stability, predictability, stableness, consistency in behavior. So the child is able to, once a child is able to go to school, the child will be able to go to school and without interruptions. The second type of separation anxiety I'm talking about in the DSM is based upon a major disruption in the environment, a stressor that the child is now feeling a sense of insecurity and anxiety that there is unexpressed. Divorce can be one. Loss of a parent can be one. Loss of a pet. Any major stressor or proximal stressor can predispose a child to separation anxiety. And where there is separation anxiety in a child, there's also generalized anxiety. Let me repeat. Where there is separation, there is also generalized anxiety. In this type of disorder, the child can be secure, and there can be insecurity. Insecure attachment versus secure attachment. It can happen to both. Unmute your mic. Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Okay, somebody's asking a question. I'm just seeing this. From viewing online, the tensions, distress a child feels when apart from caregiver. Could you explain, Vanessa, what you mean? Please explain what you mean or tell us what you're trying to say, then I'll get back. So is it clear about separation anxiety in the diocese stress model?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Any other questions? Any other questions?
Dr. Mark, just to confirm your last statement, it says where there is separation anxiety, there's going to be general anxiety.
That's correct.
Okay, madam.
And why? Because separation anxiety, generalized anxiety, in children, and we haven't done child therapy yet, but this is just we have to do psychopathology to understand therapy, while also treat the child. In a generalized anxiety, the child, the separation anxiety is in response to an attachment figure. Generalized anxiety is in response to the environment. So the child is manifesting anxiety through tummy aches, school refusal, the child is oversleeping, the child begins to fear lightning, the child is afraid of the dark. Those are signs of generalized anxiety in a child. Questions?
Yes. Does separation anxiety only occur with children?
Why? Well, in terms of the it's a developmental disorder. It is. Why? What's the why? What's your reason?
Because I'm imagining that adults also experience generalized anxiety.
Well, adults don't experience separation anxiety. Well, yes, in a sense, unless it. Look, the anxiety is rooted in as I said before, anxiety is important for all of us to have anxiety. In children, it is based upon the successful navigation of attachment. The more secure attachment, the less the anxiety. When it's disrupted, it's a major environmental stressor that the child can start regressing. But if it's in adults, it's a personality disorder. In other words, like borderlines who fear abandonment, that's where it morphs into. You see my point?
Yes, ma'am.
Any questions? Still waiting on Vanessa to send an email to explain what she's asking, not clear?
I guess she was answering the question, what is separation?
Oh, she was, oh.
I would imagine that's what
she... Oh, that's what she's... Okay, that's what she's asking. All right, are there any other questions? Okay, could you repeat for me what I said about the major models of psychopathology? I know we touched on some, but did I miss out anything else? Did I miss out anything else? Have I not touched anything? Have I touched everything? Beg your pardon?
You touched on all so far.
Have I touched everything? Now, okay, the last thing I want to talk about, which I probably didn't bring up, but I'll bring it up, is the integrative model, of models, is that this model seems to suggest that there is no one such model to explain behavior, that there is that what is known as a synthesis a synthesis, rather, of models that form that space upon what is known as a confluence model. Confluence model. And the confluence model looks primarily at the role of the individual in the family dynamic. And how the family dynamics plays a role in the development of psychopathology. The integrative model says that behaviors are complex, behaviors are unpredictable, behaviors are in a continuum. Behaviors are in a continuum. Behaviors are dynamic. That is abnormal behavior, are dynamic. They are reactive. Reactive, and they are based upon various forces. Such as temperament, attachment, personality factors, risk factors, and diatheses to explain abnormality. The model also looks at the role of the nature-nurture theory of abnormality. That psychopathology is more individual or idiopathic driven. That psychopathology or abnormality is more idiopathic or individual driven. It looks at the individual in the environment. It looks at the nature of psychological functioning. It looks at the nature of impairment. the nature of impairment. It looks at the severity of the stressors. It looks at the resilience of the individual. So we are looking at psychopathology. We were looking at psychopathology as both a dimensional and a categorical approach. Unmute your mics. I've been blabbering and ranting and manic. Questions? Any questions? Anybody else? Any questions?
None for me, Dr.
One for you?
None for me.
Oh, none for you. Anybody else?
No, Dr. Mark.
Is it clear as crystal or as mud? Any questions, ladies and gentlemen?
Dr. Mark.
Yes, yes.
We have looked at several models. In terms of, is it that we incorporate all the models to understand behaviors or abnormalities?
Yes, it is. It is if you look at the DSM, could you unmute your mics, please? It's having a feedback here. Could you unmute your mics? You mute your mics, please. Thank you. If you look at the DSM 5 or 4, the one before that, they are more looking, as I talked about, how the individual is functioning in society. So most of the categories of disorders that you look at the DSM when we introduce it on Monday is looking at it in terms of prevalence, course, diagnostic criteria, statistical comparison to other people who have it on the bell-shaped curve. So even though the disorders in the DSM are categorized, not everybody has the same symptoms because of the interactive model. You understand? Is it clear? Unmute your mic. Is it clear?
Yes, Dr. Mark. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Any other questions, ladies and gentlemen? Are there any other questions? I've given you a lot of notes. So, any other questions? Go back. I suggest that you do is go back and read the I'm going to send you that article, but the Blackwell article also helps on abnormality and put it in this context for you to understand as you go through the DSM. Try and look at the DSM and read and try to understand what I gave you and come prepared. But please, students, for those who joined late, look at the video on abnormal behavior. And as I said, go to that link privately. We cannot put that link online because of licensure issues. So please go to the, Mr. Nyama will give you a link to go privately to view that video. So there are two videos for discussion in class on Monday. That's going to be linked to that, to the DSM. Incidentally, group one, Ms. Williams and yes. Others, are yes, you ready yes. for the presentation on Monday?
We're getting there, Dr. Mark. Getting there, Dr. Mark.
So please ensure that the PowerPoint is uploaded on the screen that people can see it as in a class. Mr. Nyama needs to get it, and I need to get a copy of it too, please.
You had said we it could be sent to you in the morning of Monday.
Yes, or early afternoon before I get home from work. That I need to look at it. But it needs That's to be fine. Put that Mr. Nyamek, it needs to be on screen that people can see it while you're presenting online.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
All right, so just to recap, I'm going to be sending the information on the developmental psychopathology. I'll be sending information on the Barlow article and to encourage people to read on object relations that we will discuss much more on Monday. I deliberately left that out because it's kind of a bit heavy, so I don't want to do it tonight. Any other questions?
Dr. Mark.
Yes, Mr. Nam.
I hope that the students are aware that in week one and week two and week three, they are reading resources in a folder. The link that says reading for week one, or reading for week two, or reading for week three, you can click on that. It has a lot of documents in them. So the documents that you are thinking you can't find, you should go back to the reading.
Do you resources. Think I may have sent it to you? Do you think I may have sent those articles to you?
Yes, they are there. A lot of them are there, okay. So they need to check. And also right. in week two, I think I have put the Barlow article as a link because it was too big.
Yes.
So you have to click on it to get to it. Okay?
Okay.
So through your stuff.
So it has been there. Thank you very much for that, Mr. Nyame. So students, please, as he says, please go through the reading materials. It tells me that you're not reading them, if it's there and you're not reading. You need to be familiarize yourself with the reading. By the way, the lecture as of now ends. So the next thing I'll be doing on Monday is object relations. I'll be tying in that with personality and attachment. And I'm going to go into the DSM. However, I don't think we'll be finishing with that topic on Monday. So while we're here this evening, are we able to come in for next Saturday to conclude this? Is there a consensus, yes or no?
As long as it's the same time as today.
Yes, it's the same time.
But I should be available.
I should not be
available Saturday.
Beg your pardon?
Yes, Dr. Mark.
This is Eileen. I should not be available Saturday. I'm going to be out of town on Saturday.
Okay, but you can also, if you're not going to be out of town, it's an excuse absent. You need to sign in somewhere or listen in somewhere where you are.
It should be at a function, a staff function at work.
A staff function?
That's for Saturday, next week, Saturday. I should be here for Monday, but not Saturday.
Okay, well, your responsibility then is to watch the recorded version. Mr. Nyame, are you recording this tonight?
Yes, it is recording, but I'm waiting for us to pray before I stop.
Yes.
So before you stop though, Dr. Mac, I have a question. I noticed that for the post this week is supposed to be sent in on Tuesday and not Monday. Is that correct?
That's correct. Okay. Thank you for raising that issue. The post is Tuesday, ladies and gentlemen, and may I comment that the posts are much more substantial and quality.
Thank you, Dr. Mac.
I'm very, beg your pardon? Hello?
The post for the readings. Yes, I believe I saw a set of reading for the post and some other readings, so I was wondering if to only incorporate the reading for the post.
No, whatever the reading is for the post. No. The reading, I am certain Mr. Nam was very, very clear in making a distinction between the discussion post readings and the general readings. I'm certain he was very, very clear about
right,
that.
Right, that's what
I'm resource.
So there is a PDF file on the DSM to comment, and you are to be critical in your context, whether Jamaica or Guyana. You are meant to be critical, and I want you to interact with the material. Be critical. So don't just write down what you read. Just be interrelate with it, that I can see that you're reading. Some people have been doing much, much better. And there's a really outstanding post that I will not comment, but very good.
Dr. Mac.
Yes.
Also, just a quick question about the posting. If somebody responds to a post and we respond to their response on the, say for instance, Thursday, because it was posted too late on Wednesday.
Yes.
Is that okay? That's okay?
No. Well, to be honest, I don't see where that the post being late is going to, because we have given you, today is what? You have Sunday, Monday to post.
No. What I'm saying is that I make a post at the right time. And
yes.
Somebody responds to me at the right time.
And if you make another post again?
Right. If I can respond to that post.
Yes,
afterwards.
As long as you have done your two posts within the mandated time frame, I don't really care. Okay? I just need some time.
Okay.
Someone says, I won't be able to attend as I have a wedding. So people have weddings. Okay, well. I don't know. So people have people have plans on this coming Saturday. Mr. Nyame, I don't know. We're in for problems. I mean, what do you suggest?
How many persons are able to make it?
Yeah.
So far, two people have said that they cannot make it.
I have a funeral at 1 o'clock in the country. Not sure what time I will get back in town.
So oh dear.
Can I suggest Thursday? If that's a bad day for anyone.
Yes, it is.
I have a function at 7 o'clock.
Very bad day.
Bad day.
Is there anybody else apart from those ones? People, please speak up. We need to know now.
I might not be able to attend.
Thursday's out for me.
I have a function at 7 o'clock on Saturday.
Okay, so people are having other challenges for Saturday. I don't know. Maybe a problem. Don't know what. I don't know.
But can we then use Friday, Dr. Mark?
It's up to Mr. Nyame. If he'll be gracious to do that. I don't have a problem with that at all.
No, Friday is not good for me.
Okay.
Only Saturday or the on Monday.
Dr. Mark, guys, I hear one saying Saturday is a bad day. What about Saturday in the morning? I know it's Saturday.
No,
morning,
that is bad. That is bad. Right. That is bad for me.
That's out Saturday evening.
Dr. Mark, may I suggest something for those persons who can make it and those who have not said they can make it, yes or no, yet? And since it's been taped, can you go ahead with who is here and then the rest can watch it after, so at least it's done?
That's not a problem with me. It needs to be done because I don't think I want to have, you know, so people must people must be responsible for watching this video. If you can't make it because of a function, can't be bind you to it because it's we're doing this extra, but you must be responsible. Once it's taped, like this tonight's lecture, you are responsible for the information.
Dr. Mark?
Yes, Mr. Nam.
Hello, Jean wants to know if you could explain what is expected of the students for the individual video project.
Okay, a good question, and thanks for raising that issue. What I want the individual movie, as I said to people, is that there is a list of designated movies that were given to you with a list. There's also some instructions that you had received. You are to review the movie, and it should be from YouTube, that I can have access to it. But when you are responding, you're going to be looking at a character study using the DSM-5 diagnosis of a person in the movie, or characters in the movie, or character in the movie. And then you're going to be using the guidelines to writing that paper.
And we shouldn't deviate from the guidelines, Dr. Max. So everything that you have there, just use
everything that I have there is to be used. If I didn't, if I wanted a deviation, I would not have put it there.
Okay.
Dr. Max?
Yes.
I had challenge opening those videos. I had challenge opening them. I can't access them.
You have challenges what?
I can't access any of the videos.
What do you mean you can't access any of the videos? Which ones?
I told Mr. Yami about it.
Which videos you can't access?
The ones for the individual paper.
You have to type it into YouTube.
No, type it into YouTube.
I did that, Dr. Mark, and yet they tell me I need to sign in for something which I don't know, and I spent it Mr. Yami about it.
Okay, well, did you talk to him about that? Because I can't help you with, but...
I did, Dr. Mark.
But people can get YouTube in Jamaica, right?
Yeah, but not all the movies are going to be available online on YouTube. Only some of them.
From Jamaica?
I don't have any of those. Yeah, not even from Jamaica in general, because they really try to uphold copyright. So you may find movies on there, but you may not find all of them. They have been cutting back on that.
Well, okay, but I know the Color Purple is there. Okay, but Mr. Chiana, how would you resolve that issue then with the movie? Is there a movie you have that you can watch and at least let me know?
I will do that, Dr. Mark.
Well, it has to be something that I have to approve, though.
Yes, Dr. Mark.
Okay, so if you have issues with that, then let me know, and I'll make alternative arrangements. But I wanted to be able to go to YouTube and look at the movie myself.
Okay, Dr. Matt.
All right, Dr. Matt, back to Saturday, because we have 9 students, and out of the 9 so far, 4 are unable to make it. Not sure if Vanessa will be able to make it. Haven't heard from Marshallie or Mr.
Can we get some answers from them this evening if they can make it? Hello?
Or Mr. Victor?
I said Saturday I'm okay with Saturday evening.
What you said?
I am okay with Saturday evening.
Okay.
So we have 6 people then. Do we have 6 people? I think if we have students who are able to make it, let us still have it on Saturday. Since Mr. Nyama is available, and he's a very key pivotal piece in this technology that we are to have the class. I don't know of any other way.
Well, for now, we have 3 persons. I don't know if Mr. Mr. K. I remember your name.
Kedo?
Right. Kido, right. He hasn't responded as yet, did you? He's looking, but he's not saying anything.
Is he able to make it, class?
Can you please repeat what I said? I'm not hearing you properly.
No, we were just wondering if you'd be able to meet the class on Saturday next.
Yes, I said that. Yes, I'm
okay. We will have a class on Saturday then. The students who are missing must view it after it has been recorded. We will have a class. We'll continue with this.
For three have confirmed, but not so sure what Vanessa and Marshall are doing. So at least three of us will be there. And it will be taped, so the rest can watch it.
Yes. All right. If there are no questions, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for indulging me this evening and for showing some of you patches of what I call erudite learning. You have learned tonight. I think it was a great class. I enjoyed it.
Thank you, Dr. Mack.
Any other questions?
Dr. Mack, you had mentioned in one of your emails about a learning website. It's the same one that Coach
is saying. It's the same, yes. We cannot put it up on the Moodle platform. They're going to attract a lot of licensing. We don't want that. We don't have money to spend, students to spend. So please go there. You are to watch that video or the videos I gave you for the class. On Monday, it's a class video. We can't watch it online. It will be illegal. So
three
you have
of them
to
are there. Three of them are there already. So, Koja, the one that Dr. Max speaks of is already there?
No.
Okay.
No, I'm going to send a link in your email.
Okay, because there are three other videos there already.
Yes, but there's one that just talks about the link. To the next, to the actual website. So you check for that one. I'll send you a link and email.
So Dr. Matt, there's that link and there's another one in the video clip that he has already sent that we need to watch.
Well, how many videos were sent, Mr. Naomi?
Three.
Okay, those are short clips. They are not long to watch.
Okay, I think one is on DSM.
Yes, that needs to be watched, please.
Okay.
That's important. Here. Yes.
As it relates to feedback from the forums, I believe I heard some time ago that you would respond to the first one and not the others.
No, I will not be responding to the other forums. I will be grading that for the next three forums. That is worth 25% of the grade. So I will send once I'm concluded with the post, I will send that to you by email of the grade and your performance.
At the end of the 3 weeks or each week?
No, ending of 3 weeks.
Okay.
And Dr. Mack, a question from me here, just to be certain, in terms of the post that we're to make, is it a summary of the information the information that you'd have sent us that you're expecting?
What do you mean? Week three had a question.
Psychiatric diagnosis,
yes.
Help or hindrance. So,
yes.
Is it that you're expecting us to review the literature, the information that you would have sent us?
No, the literature, you are to respond to that article every week, and the special article is posted in the discussion article forum, and you are to respond to that article in the light of your comments about the article. That's why I am saying people need to focus on the article. Okay, there was an article sent about the DSM-5 diagnosis. I expect you to read the article and to talk about the article and to be more critical of it in the light of the Jamaican situation. In other words, is diagnosis, is it a hindrance or a help? As related to the article, what's your opinion? But you need to be critical of the article. Do you agree or don't agree? Is it clear?
So what is your expectation then of us in terms of wider reading for...
You can do that, but I must see clear evidence of the mention with that article I post of the discussion forum. So when you're posting, you must make reference to that article.
So all right? That's more like the center, and everything else is peripheral.
Yeah, well, yes, in a sense.
Okay.
Any other questions? My battery is going because I didn't plug in my laptop, so it's running down. So I have 60 minutes of power left before it goes out. But any questions?
It's a sign. It's a sign, Dr. Mark. It's a sign.
A sign. A sign of bedtime.
Dr. Mark. Have a good night.
All right, so I see where, yes?
No, I was just saying to Hello Jean and Latoya, if they're still on, if they could remain a little bit. Is that okay with you, Kojo?
Yeah, you can stay as long as you want. If I'm gone, okay, you're great. Still there. But we'll
fantastic.
Have to stop the recording, but you have to
that's
pray.
Okay. That's okay. Thanks, Dr. Ma.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for a good lecture this evening. And again, to remind people that they need to read the handout on object relations, watch the videos for the class on Monday, and come prepared to answer questions. What I'll be wrapping up just going into object relations and attachment and introducing the DSM-5. So we hope to start, the earlier we start, the better we'll be able to hang on and hold on. Okay? Have a good Sunday, everybody.
Oh, one last question, Dr. Mark. In doing the papers, there are some references that refer to the DSM-4 because I guess they wouldn't have any DSM-5 references.
What papers? What papers?
The group work.
No, no, no. But I strongly recommend that you consult the DSM-5 with regard to the diagnostic category.
No, that's fine. No, that's fine. Okay. I'm talking about the other aspects of it where you would have to find references in terms of introduction
did you check EXCO? But if as long as the information is close to what's in the DSM-5, you can feel free to use it.
Okay, Dr. Mark. Thank you.
Yeah, because the DSM just started last year, so there's not been much time for books to update themselves. Okay? I'm not going to hold you to that.
Right, Dr. Mark. Thank you very much, Dr. Mark.
All right, are there any other questions? So, people are wanting to leave. I am... It's after 11, it's 10:30 almost by my watch. We have spent a long time tonight, so I thank you. Have a good evening, everybody. Thank you. Go ahead.
Okay. Father, we thank you for this evening, Lord. We thank you that you, again, have made it possible that we went through this recording glitch-free. We thank you for your mercies in that regard, Lord. We thank you that a lot of things were shared, Lord, and that a lot of learning took place. We ask, Lord, that you continue to bless us, and you continue to give each student, Lord, guidance, give them your knowledge, wisdom, and your understanding, and your revelation, so that they can comprehend and reproduce with excellence. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.